Irina Kirsanova, remembering Nikita Dolgushin. Upon completing my training at the Vaganova Academy of Russian Ballet in Leningrad, I joined the Mikhailovsky Theatre, or the Maly Opera Theatre, where I met the inimitable Nikita Dolgushin, a dancer and choreographer. My first role was in the Размышления. It was a ballet based on Shakespeare's Hamlet, where I danced Ophelia and Dolgushin danced Hamlet. I was 18, he was 38. Nikita Dolgushin was a true artist, a gentleman and a brilliant dancer. I took part in all his projects and experiments as a choreographer. I remember doing some stretching exercises on the verge of impossibility when Nikita revived one of Marie Taglioni's lessons. We used to come to the theater at 8 o'clock in the morning, much earlier than the official start of our workday. At that time, Dolgushin seemed to be inspired by the duet of my husband and partner, Yuri Petukhov, and myself. That was the beginning of our love, and this moved Nikita to stage Epitaph on the Death of Romeo and Juliet. This was a further generous gift I received from him. The piece begins with Romeo mourning over Juliet's body, so a good half of the performance I spent in the arms of my beloved. The piece is full of incredibly beautiful lifts. Dolgushin was a true esthete. Everything had to be beautiful, even death. I was dancing in a charming dress and had a beautiful hairstyle. Nikita asked me to dance with my eyes closed. He wanted me to really feel the emotional richness of the piece. Dolgushin wanted me to be passionate and loving. He wanted me to cry about my love and for the whole world to hear my why. Two souls met and perished. The piece portrays Juliet and Romeo caught between death and life. The piece had very interesting choreography, and though we were desperately fighting fate and each other, how could that have happened? The ending of the piece was very beautiful. We were under a receding spotlight so that the audience would first see the two bodies embracing each other, and then only the two faces, which seemed to be carried away into eternity. There was a captivating, even poetic finale. No one could remain unmoved. We performed the piece all over, in Japan, in America, even in small villages in Tajikistan. And the audience was invariably either silent or hushed when we were dancing. It was a silence that touched the heart. I remember one particular performance. We went to dance at some factory in Tajikistan, and there were only men in the audience. It was at the end of their work day, and many of them had never seen ballet before. The stage floor was in very bad shape, and they couldn't even turn the lights off completely. Yuri had to carry me, dead, onto the stage in his arms. He put me down on the stage floor and our performance began. While Yuri was still carrying me onto the stage, the audience started to giggle and was about to burst into laughter. Then gradually the audience not only fell silent, but held their breath. There was a dead hush when we finished, and then they gave us a storm of applause. Dolgushin was proud of us, and he did not let anyone else dance this piece. It was quite interesting to live through that production from within. It seemed like you lived through a whole life while dancing it. When I had to, so to say, rise from the dead to come back to real life, I was always in a certain meditative state. That was a complete immersion. The music by Albinoni was still a novelty for that piece, and Nikita had found a particularly beautiful original interpretation of the melody. He had also found an interesting way to illuminate the stage. This piece will probably die with us. It was a great success of Nikita Dolgushin, the choreographer. Then there was a specter de la rose. Dolgushin was, and I can hardly talk about him in the past tense, he was so energetic and charming, so lively and active, so ironical. He was an aesthete to the very bone. He was an actor in both his work and life. It was as though he was always watching himself from afar, and though he acted at being Nikita Dolgushin. That is why his rehearsals were always performances in their own right, where he was at the same time a teacher, an actor, and a partner. He inspired us immensely. Those weren't rehearsals, but true performances. He was a superb artist and used to come up with whole stories about each particular gesture. Oddly enough, when I saw him lately, he looked upset by young dancers who were unable to understand him or his ideas. When I ask a dancer to tell me what Giselle had been doing before she came out of the house, they laughed. With the Spectre de la Rose, he made his own version. Sometimes it seemed he was dissecting the original style. Other times he seemed to be carried away. In this performance, he rendered very accurately the world of art from the beginning of the last century and its atmosphere. They gave me a dress. It was a real ball gown. Nikita made it himself. It was made of such a heavy cloth, a low-cut dress with long sleeves. I was wearing a large cap with roses on my head, just like the photograph of Tamara Kirsanova, the first performer of that role. They made me a schlafrock, a short coat. A window was brought onto the stage and the scenery looked quite realistic. Dolgushin paid much attention to every aspect of the production. How he made me breathe. It was important to him how I inhaled the scent of the rose. He also insisted that I dance as if sleeping with my eyes closed. The story, after all, is about a girl who had fallen asleep and is visited by a ghost of the rose. Nobody had ever danced this piece like that before. In its style and movement, it was retro, the old style. But with no legs lifted too high, no exaggerated gestures, everything was very elegant and beautiful. Yuri Petukhov was dancing the ghost of the rose. Dolgushin worked him long and hard. He made Yuri hold his hand a special way like Nijinsky, so that the tips of his fingers looked like rose petals, touching and withering, so different from the classical hand. He even helped Yuri sew rose petals onto his costume and cap. Dolgushin did everything there was to be done to guarantee success. Later on, Dolgushin staged Tchaikovsky's fantasy overture, Romeo and Juliet, for Petukhov and me. Then followed Giselle. Rehearsals were interesting. He thought me to be an old school dancer. My domain was romantic ballet. That is why in our Giselle, we followed the style of Olga Spesivtseva, a star dancer of the beginning of the 20th century. He had found very old films with her dancing Giselle and had me watch them. I noticed that even the choreography was somewhat different there than from the canonical version. The stage then was smaller than it is now. That's probably why the first diagonal in Giselle's variation was divided in two, and its second half was performed in the opposite direction. I also noticed some changes in the combinations at the midpoint through the variation, and yet I could learn how Spesivtseva moved. Dolgushin wanted me to carry the air of oldness. He would teach me to walk as though I were treading on rose petals, to move silently and with ease, to be weightless when jumping. We also found an interesting solution for the madness scene. His idea for the scene was rather original. At that time, I had long, beautiful hair. By the way, earlier, when I told you about the epitaph on the death of Romeo and Juliet, I did not mention that first I had a sleek hairstyle, very much like a Filippo Lippi's Madonna. It was rather hard to dance with a hairstyle like that. What I needed then was the image of complete freedom. When I told Dolgushin about that, he rejected my idea completely. He said, no, no, no. Nonetheless, once I let my hair down, I prevailed. Now, coming back to Giselle, it's worthwhile to mention that Dolgushin built the whole of the madness scene around my unbound hair. The hair would stream down very beautifully, then break like a wave opening and covering my face time and again. Just as we were rehearsing this very bit, Svetlana Sheina, another very famous ballet mistress at our theater, once came into the studio. My God, what is that? She said disapprovingly. And yet what we were doing was very interesting. Unfortunately, at our theater, Dolgushin was not given the chance to bring this work to a conclusion. Later on, he would do that in his own theater at the Conservatory of Music, where he worked as director for many years. I did dance Giselle, but many years later. I did it with the legendary Alla Scherest, who had danced that part in Leningrad. We did it in the classical style of Nesterov. Let's go back to Dolgushin. It was always a pleasure to work with him. When I joined the theater, he was already a senior dancer. There is always a certain bias in any theater. Well, Dolgushin was a poor fit at the Maly Opera Theater, just like he had been a poor fit at the then Kirov Theater, and had to leave it. Nikita was never much like others. He was special. At times, Dolgushin was rather difficult to understand. What was he really like? He was not easy nor open. It was difficult to visualize him when he was alone. I was wondering if he slept in the posture of Hamlet. His strangeness was annoying to many, as well as the fact that he had his own vision. He excited everybody and everything, and the theater did not welcome that kind of behavior. Dolgushin craved self-fulfillment. So, when they would not let him dance, he did choreography and drawing. He was a Scorpio, a man of action. He organized his own theater at the Conservatory of Music. He built his troupe from scratch. They worked productively and well. People may argue about their personal likes and dislikes, but it was real theater. It was the age of Dolgushin. When they took his theater away, it was a tragedy for Nikita and for his people. It is strange how normal taking something away and destroying it is thought to be. It was a hard blow for Nikita. The Conservatory of Music had now turned into a wasteland. Pietukhov and I tried to help Dolgushin. We even accepted his dances at our theater. We told him, let them work in our troupe for a while. When you get back to theater, your people will be in good shape and shall return to you. We were very fond of Nikita. He was the teacher to us. It was so wonderful when Farukh Ruzimatov invited Dolgushin and Alla Osipenko as choreographers at the Mikhailovsky Theatre. That was the best offer anyone could make Dolgushin then. That is why so many years later Nikita returned to the theater, where he had once starred as a dancer during the time when Oleg Vinogradov was the director. That was the peak of Dolgushin's dancing career. He was so splendid in Giselle, Coppelia, and La Fille Margardée, where he danced with Tatiana Fisenko. Later, when the choreographer Mikhail Boyarshchikov became the director of the theater, Dolgushin brilliantly danced the part of Tsar Boris in Razbojniki. Besides that, Dolgushin also staged performances himself. He staged a wonderful version of Paquita. He was first to restore the old style of that original ballet. It was perfect in costume design and in style. Dolgushin himself danced brilliantly in that performance. Aesthetically, he was absolutely flawless. He knew how his legs should open when he would do batteries, how the shadows should fall onto his shoulder. He knew exactly where the eyes should look at every particular moment. He used to say that every little detail on stage was quite noticeable, down to the movement of eyelashes. Everything was important. In Paquita, he made the girls wear wigs, and their costumes were made to copy the true historical era. A long tutu with attached bodice. The color scheme of the costumes was also well thought out. Female costumes matched the color of the Mikhailovsky Theatre. They were apricot, even terracotta in color. Dolgushin himself appeared on the stage in a pearly costume. He was wearing no wig, and his tight costume demonstrated his remarkable proportions. That way, all the female dancers on the stage served to highlight his extraordinary beauty. He looked irresistible. His partners, Valya Mukhanova or Tatiana Fisenko, were also wearing a costume of the same pearly color. His partners were either. I remember one particular rehearsal when he told me, "Remember that on the stage we're wearing real diamonds and everything is real. The audience is filled with your admirers who had given you jewelry. Now you must show them all that splendor here and there. It would not be too bad to receive even more gifts." So he told me those things, and it became clear how I should dance. Dolgushin was an expert in women's nature. He knew how to admire a woman. Recently, Nikita had completely changed his image. He began to look like Salvador Dali. He wore such a wonderful mustache. I remember him in his beautiful gray suit. He was so good that you would not even think to ask his age. By the way, he danced in his last Giselle when he was already 60. I attended that performance. It seemed he would never stop dancing. Then when he passed away, we all realized what a loss that was. It all happened so unexpectedly. Dolgushin was invited to the French Grand Opera House to give a series of master classes. That was his finest hour, his swan song. I believe it was his success at the Grand Opera House, which was too demanding emotionally on him, something he couldn't cope with. Dolgushin was internally very emotional. He simply gave out more than he could. He burnt out all of his reserves. To him, it was like a satisfaction for all the previous sorrows of the time when he had not been needed. How did they dare take away from him the theater that he had built? A true master. That was a crime. Dolgushin was supposed to give the second master class at the Grand Opera House when he felt unwell during lessons. He recovered a little at a very good clinic in Paris, and everything seemed to be all right. Although on his return to St. Petersburg, he fell ill again. Doctors did all they could, but unfortunately it wasn't enough. Nobody really believed he could pass away like that. We all were shocked when it happened. Dolgushin's death was a hard blow to me. I felt abandoned. I realized there had been a very special bond between us. Nikita had seemed to pass his knowledge and his love from his soul to mine. I felt then that a very close friend was gone, and I was left with a void in my heart. His funeral was very special. Everything was beautiful. The Mikhailovsky Theatre draped in black velvet. They played music by Albinoni and other classical melodies. High officials of the state sent their telegrams. Crowds of people came. Everybody spoke of him highly. What a genius he had been. As it always happens, they all seem to remember how good Nikita had been, only when he was no longer with us. When he had been alive, nobody needed him, just like nobody needed the great Alla Shelest, who spent her days in her apartment, forgotten by everybody. Many came to say their last farewells to Dolgushin. Flowers, tears. It was somewhat pompous. They all knew they were saying farewell to the king. I even caught myself thinking that Nikita may have staged his own funeral. One thing is true, he would have liked them. The funeral was worthy of him. He even died in a beautiful way, as an actor. I don't remember anybody else passing away like that. Dolgushin's death is a huge loss, of course. Such people pass away, and I fear for the future of our ballet, as I do not see anyone who could replace them. I fear that our ballet tradition might die as well.